Hey and welcome back. Today I'm gonna go through a little bit of theory, but basically for what we build, basically we're building this. This is a MIPS CPU or MIPS computer. The memory is included here, registers. This video is a very good explanation on how you execute an instruction, how you decode and execute it. It's called Instruction Breakdown Data Path Tutorial by Progressive Learning Platform. So link in the description, watch it, can only recommend it. As you might be able to see down here, they color coded the instruction. This is an R-type instruction. So it's three registers. Basically you see opcode is zero, that's for all the R-type instructions. Then the three registers, shift amount and function. And you can see how that's decoded. So the first six bits go, so the opcode goes into the control. So we will basically build something like this. Not necessarily in one spot. And some of those we don't really need separate control signals for, because we can just test for a certain condition of the opcode. So for example, we will have a signal register write, which will be set if the instruction that we are currently executing has the right to run register. Most of the instructions do, like additions, load memory, just only the store instructions, I believe, and jumps don't, except for jump and link, which does write to the registers. There's something similar for memory write. So for the store instructions, we're writing to memory, and then mem to register is also very important, which will basically tell, you can just follow this line, which will control this mux, and this mux decides whether we write to the register from memory, as the name says, of the control signals. But the other case is also very important. If you follow this line, that's the output of the LU. Also, another note, we won't be following this too strictly, because for example, this ALU also computes, as you can see, the ALU output is used as an address for the memory access. For the address, we will just have a separate combinator for that. So we don't use our ALU for that, but we will just use a combinator somewhere else, because it's always, a load instruction is always, hey, take this immediate, add it to the value from that register, and that's the address. Okay, so yeah, take a look at this video. I have the same here, which you might have seen in the last video. Basically, it's only highlighted the control signals, so we're mostly interested in those. We already, last episode, we already built, or over the last episodes, we built the memory, right? So they have it separate here, but in reality, also in a real MIPS computer, it's one memory. So you kind of just have a memory with two. Where you need to be able to read from two addresses at the same time, or you have to do it in two steps. Both is possible. If you do it in two steps, you would first read from the memory the instruction, and then store that into a register, and then you can execute instructions, and the memory is free to be used again for reading, writing. Another resource I use a lot is this book, yeah, System Architecture as an Ordinary Engineering Discipline, version 0.40. So I'm not sure if it's out there yet. It was supplied for my system architecture lecture, which I took in, I believe, 2012, actually. So let's go over it. So those are the instructions. These two pages, and as you can see, they are split in I-type, R-type, and J-type. And those types, they don't really say anything about the instruction, the kind of instruction that's in here. As you can see, there are loads, stores, some memory related. Then there are additions and logical operators and branches. If you go to the R type, there are again additions and stuff. So it's not that additions are in a separate type. It's what the type tells you is how they are encoded. So that's very important. So we want to differentiate between those three types and then be able to decode each type. And our decoder, which you will see in a few minutes, just decodes every kind of instruction at the same time. And then you just, if you are a, for example, if I would be seeing any of this code, opcode, then I would know, okay, I have to take the values I decoded from the instruction when I assumed I was an I-type. So I would, for example, so I-type is, there's a diagram down here, I believe. Yeah. I-type is basically then two registers and a 60-bit immediate. So an immediate is just the content, like really 16-bit number that's stored in the instructions that's used, for example, also for addition. When you do add immediate, you're basically adding the content of this register to this immediate. And registers are always 5 bits because we have 32 registers, so 0 through 31. And then for R-type, you have 3 registers in here, so you can do add this register to this register and store it in this register. That's also interesting fact that depending on which type you are in, either you write back your result to this register or this. And you can see this in the data path with this MUX. You also can see the parts of the instruction here. They're just not annotated what kind of part that is. This is the opcode. This is the source register. So this is always just being read. The second register we can also just read. And that's basically what our logic will do. And then we write to which register we write depends on this control signal. So either from, as you can see, either we write to RT or RD. And you can see that demonstrated here. I believe this is RT and this is RD. And that depends on the rec destination control flag here, which is basically whether we are in a I-type or R-type instruction. So there's also some logic down here, which tells us, yeah, exactly here. If we are an R-type, so just the conditioned opcode needs to be 0 for R-type. For J-type, it needs to be, basically either 2 or 3. That's the binary for 2 and 3. And then I-type is everything else. You can just also take a look here. J-type is really only 2 and 3. And J-type are the jumps to a fixed address. So that address is in this instruction and it's 26 bits. So you can't exactly jump everywhere, but then you don't really need to. Okay, that's about that. Yeah, I'm following this a little bit more like a help. And I also, for the control signals, I made my own table because I couldn't find a good table. This book also describes it a little bit. So I made a table on paper. And basically, I put the control signals I put on there were jump branch. You can see them over here. So those are important to select the next PC from those two MUXes. And then we have memory to register, which we already saw here. So this decides what we will write to the register. I have memory write, something I call ALU source. I believe, oh yeah, that's just this, the signal that controls this MUX. So no, that's wrong. Oh yeah, ALU source tells this MUX. It's called ALU source here as well. So this either takes the register's second operand or the immediate value from an I-type instruction, signed extended though. It's not always signed extended, so this diagram is not completely correct. I think they didn't consider logical operators. The and so the bitwise and OR and XOR and NOR are they don't sign extend the immediate. Well, and NOR doesn't exist for immediate type instructions, but yeah, basically AND immediate or immediate and XOR immediate, they take the immediate, not sign extended. So I also have sign extension in my table, but this is one for everything except for those couple of instructions. And then I also have register write, which will be true for the, basically for all the arithmetic instructions, shifts, addition, subtractions, and or SLT, which is set less than, which will basically do a comparison and set then the result to 0 or 1, depending on it. Register write will just not be active for jump register, jump, and the store instructions, so store byte, store half, and store word. I believe they are also 0 for branches. Yeah, they should be 0 for, you don't write to a register in a branch. And branches are just conditional jumps, so. Yeah, so maybe keep this in mind. And next off, we will build this part. We already did this part last episode, so we got the opcode out of the instruction. Off camera, I also selected the other signals from the instructions, and we will now go over that, how that works. I'll just go over it quick. We left off with loading the instruction and getting the opcode out of it. So depending on the opcode, you can decide if it's an R-type, J-type, or I-type, where R-type take three registers. So it's basically just, for example, add register A to register B and store it in register C. And so the types of the instructions determine the instruction encoding. They're not like grouped into arithmetic or something, it's just the encoding of the instruction. Of course, all instructions have the opcode, and the R-type has three registers, RS, RT, RD, a shift amount, and a function. The function, 6 bits, and determines the ALU operation, for example, shift, shift, addition, subtraction, and then with or without overflow, and well, bitwise AND, OR, XOR, and NOR, which we can all just do with the arithmetic combinators. Not so sure how we will handle overflow and the shifts, because we only have two shifts, and MIPS has, for right shift, there is a logical shift and a arithmetic shift. So logical means if you shift right, you will just add zeros to the left, and if you shift arithmetic, you might add ones to the left if the most significant bit was already a one, and with two complement numbers, if the most significant bit is a one, that means the number is negative. So if we shift right, we still want it to be negative, so we have to sign extended, basically, so we will add then ones to the left to keep it negative, and yeah. Okay, and then there are some other R-type instructions like jump register and jump and link register, which are kind of a special case. I guess we will handle them last. I think we will start with the arithmetic instructions. Maybe then, yeah. Okay, let's continue with J-type instructions. J-type, I think they're called J, so R-type I think it's called because they take registers and operate only on registers. Except for a shift amount. For the shift instructions, the shift amount can be basically an immediate, which is stored in the R-type instruction. It's only 5 bits, so I'm not sure why they didn't put it into the I-type, but we will come to I-type in a second. Then there's J-type instruction. There are only two, so that's jump and jump and link, and J-type instructions are encoded with the opcode, and the rest of the bits, which are 26 bits, is then the index, or it's kind of the address to jump to, except the least significant 2 bits are truncated because we can only jump to addresses which are 32 bit aligned anyway, so we don't need those 2 bits. And then since the opcode already takes 6 bits, we just save 2 on the address we want to jump to, so we would still need 4 bits, and those 4 bits are just taken from the current PC, I think. Yeah, and then there are the I-type instructions which have immediate values. Those are, for example, add immediate, so they take 2 registers. So first of all, they still have the opcode, then they have RS and RT, which are 2 registers, and then they have 16-bit immediate. For example, it's used for load upper immediate and then OR immediate to load immediates into memory. But you can also, for example, add register A to the immediate value in the instruction and store it in register B. Okay, so those are decided mostly by the opcode. By the opcode. So if the opcode is 0, it's always R-type, and the function number, which is the 6 least significant bits then of the instruction, determine which R-type instruction it is. J-type is really easy because it's either 2 or 3, because they're only jump and jump and link. So I just have either 2 or 3, so let me just fix that. Equals to 2, equals to 3, and then either one will output a 1. So the J signal here will be 1 in either case. For I-type, that's a little bit more complicated. Basically, it's if it's not R or J-type. But that means it must be greater than 3, because 0, 2, and 3 are R-type or J-type, and or it's 1. So we can, I didn't want to nor this basically, those two. So if it's not this or this, because this would make the circuit deeper, which adds more delay. So we can compute all those just after we get the opcode. And then I also extracted the other parts of the instruction, which are the function code for R-type instructions. And I think this one is an I-type instruction. It's at immediate unsigned, I think, something. So this is not relevant here, but we can still nevertheless decode it, right? Immediate is 2, yeah, because I think this is a add 2 to T1 unsigned, yeah. Then shift amount is 0. RS is 0 because we RS is the source register. So we use register 0, which is always 0, and then the target register is 9, that's T1, I believe. So we're adding 2 to 0 and storing it in T1. And RD is not isn't used for I-type instructions. I will probably lay this out differently later. what I did is to pull all those signals onto the green wire here. So O is opcode, F is function, M is immediate, and S is shift amount, it's zero, N is I index, which is the jump address kind of for the J type instructions, which is zero. And then we have A, which is RS. We have B, which is RT, which is 9, so that's T1 in this case, and C, RD. And then we have R, J, and I, which are the bits here, which type of instruction it is. Let's maybe start with... So the write register is either RD or RT, depending of if it's an R type. Let's maybe do that. So if it's RD, if you are R type, so where's our thing? So this is the, so we have to put this as W on here. So if R is true, actually, yeah, then output okay. I think I want a multiplier here. Maybe we'll have it here. So if it's RD is C times R is see, we can rename here now. This will be W, right? And it's RT otherwise, so that's B. If it's a I type, wait, we have J type first, right? So if it's an I type, and if it's a J type, it's that as well. Well, if it's a J type, we don't write to any register, so we might need to post this though. So I think everything is on here, right? Oh, that's the wrong cable. Yeah, okay, now we have, we write to register 9. That's correct. For now, I'm gonna take W. Yeah, let's use that. It really doesn't matter too much. If internal, take the input count of W. So, and then I just want a push button to trigger it. So this doesn't output W yet. And then, does this reach? No. Maybe if we move it down here. Yeah, okay. So now we can write to the register. And the value to write is set to 42, so we should be able to write 42 to it. But what we really want to write is coming from a multiplexer, which is either the output of a addition. Oh yeah, because we're adding a register and a immediate. Okay. I guess we want a multiplexer for the input. So the first input to DL is always the register RS, and then we either add the immediate or RT and then store it in RT or RD. So we just want to multiplex between immediate and RT. But we do this and we maybe carry this up here. Okay, and that's where the ALU comes in actually. Well, let's have just addition, which I do one here, one plus, no wait, so it's RT. Also, we need to load RT actually, because this is only the register number, right? I guess we will just put RS and RT onto the register file read thingy. So those two, unfortunately they are on red. I believe this one should be the read select. So RS and RT. So we don't even have to put them on here actually. Let's disconnect this. We can keep the shift amount on here for now. We have this connected to this multiplexer, plus the trigger for writing, and now RS and RT have to go into onto this guy here. So okay, now we have B equals 9 and A equals 0, and because we're an I type instruction. Oh wait, I think I did the wrong one. We're reading RS and RT and writing it to RD, right? Oh no, we're an I type instruction right now, so that's why we are writing to RT. But we still need to read RS, which is 0, so we get back 0. But now we have, actually on here, we read register 0, which is always 0. So we need to pull that into the LU. It's kind of hard to see what the max distance is. I guess I can't stretch this any longer. So I'll have another one over here, I guess. And this should really go into here. Okay. This should also go into this area here, but it's just a prototype, right? You can always move stuff around pretty easily. So this is going up here, which is reading, And this goes into DLU. So both registers go, yeah, we need to mux again. Either we take the immediate or RT. And obviously we take RT if we are R-type. Okay, so let's have to... Oh no, we can actually... Let's move this away a little bit. Okay, we have this signal here. So we can say, did we do it down here? R. If we are R-type, we take RT, so that's B. But B from here. And if we are I, so, okay, B times R-type, and this is the immediate, which is M, times we are I-type, and I'm gonna output both on 1. That's just for internal signals. So we can see the immediate the output of this mux is 2. If we have, where does the instruction come in here, right? Yeah, on P. I'm gonna disconnect that. Or maybe... Yeah, I'm gonna disconnect this. And... Maybe have a couple of predefined instructions here. P is... so 0x24, 09, 0002. That's my I-type. Yeah, my I-type instruction. So as we had before, and now I want a... Actually, let's copy that to here. Let's have an R-type instruction here. This one isn't so good, or let's take this one. This at you, 0x00095021. So now you can see function is 33, which is at you. I can look that up in my table. We don't use an immediate. Registers are 9 and 10, which is correct. Not completely though. Oh yeah, I think it is. They are kind of weirdly ordered sometimes, so... Okay. And let's see if that works. Well, we should read the registers. So this is 9 and 0, and we write to 10. So why is this not outputting? Actually, it should connect like this. We are an R-type instruction right now, so this should take C. We either write to RD or RT. RD or just B and C, so not A. Still nothing. This one outputs 10. This output 9. Oh, I don't have control input. which is on here. So I guess I will just connect them back together. I mean, those are connected via red. So we could just connect all of them via red. Then we're reading all three registers, but that's not any additional cost. And let's put that on here as well. So we have C and B on here, and then we need the control signal, which we can take. Where's the control signal connected to? So that's on the shift amount still, but we might maybe, well, yeah, actually, let's do this. Let's connect this over here, the control signal, and then into this. So the instruction is writing to a register. Register 10, which is correct. So I just debugged the connections here. Okay. Let's switch back to the I-type instruction. So now we need the other register signal. So when I hook up RS into this one plus RS, which is A, or it's, and then we will output this on, where does the output of the LU go? Either goes into memory or into register. So there is a mux there. Let's put it on 2 for now. We need A. Why don't we? Oh, A is 0. We need the control signals though, if we actually want to write to memory or to register. But that should be the data actually, so we can just put it on W, I guess. On I. Although sometimes we want to write the value we read from. Okay, now let's set this to, what's the signal called? LU result. Don't have a name for that yet. I'll call it D. Okay. No, D. I will then have to select, depending on the opcode. If opcode, if opcode is 33, then, ah, wait, this is incorrect. Oops. And there might be multiple. This is 1. Let's rename this to 2 actually. Because it's still internal really. And then this should be subtract, really. So 33 is add u, and then sub u is 35. And then there are add and sub, but we have to figure out. We can do the and, or xor, and nor already, so. And I think for the I-type instructions, I would just have another, we can actually already do this, so. Take this input as well. And then, wait, this didn't have, okay, this should be D, yeah. Back to D again. Because we can just take the input count. So. Our output is 9 though, because. Wait, what? What instruction do we have? I thought we have add. Oh, add EU. Yeah, it's the I-type instruction. That's what I wanted to do here, so that's 9 then. Maybe let's move it like so. And a lot of like rearranging and better layouting will happen later. But yeah, we can do a little bit right now. So, and this is sub EU. Which doesn't exist, so. Because there is only an add IU. Because you can just make the immediate negative, right? So if it's 8 or 9, that changes, or 10 or 11. That changes if we sign extend it. I'll do the sign extension later. It's basically the m value will change then. Okay, so let's do the logical. There's a less than. But I believe the less than unsigned is really hard to do. So, well, it's a set less than. Let's do the and or xor and nor. I'm not sure if there's a nor. So I figure that out in a second. So how's this are. This should actually be A plus I. I mean, for plus it's not relevant, but here it's relevant. So I'll do it properly to not mess up somewhere else. I think then it's OR and then XOR. And the NOR is just a NOT OR. Where do they get A from? This is where we put the address on, so it's on here actually. Oh yeah, that's why it's going in here, because that selects either B or the immediate. But we still need A in here. Yeah, so this is correct, and then this also outputs the correct value, which is the add immediate unsigned. Okay, this is now for, yeah, and there are also the immediate variants. So this is, and just 36. This is, and immediate, which is 12. Oh no. That's the opcode, but this 33 is the function value. Oh. But then, we have to make sure that's only, used if opcode is 0. I believe we should do this This needs to program. Yeah, let's take decider. So if opcode equals 0, input count f. Which one do we have? We have an I-type instruction. So this actually takes the opcode. Wait, what? Okay, so this way we set the function to 0. Is there a function value 0? Oh yes, there is. Damn it. That's shift left logical. Yeah, you know what? Because this will save us some circuitry actually. I set this to f equals f not p. F equals 1. So we will, with that, we shift the function numbers with 1. This might actually mess some stuff up. Yeah, but no, I think we'll do the control signals as lookup anyway. But this way, except we could fix that by having another one here, which we set to minus 1. and then hook it up to here. That might. Wait, why doesn't this work? Oh yeah, and we have to connect it to this pole again. So the function is now minus one. If it's invalid. And with that we can say, yeah, so with that this will for J type and more importantly I type instruction, this will always be minus one, so this will not select. See? And I did this, I mean I could have just ended it with if it's an R type, but this makes the circuit like longer, right? Yeah, I think this is, and especially with this minus one plus one trick here. Okay, let's. So this is F, this is O. Oh. So this is. Oh. 12. And this is F. F. F, 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 F. 36. Oh, by the way. Oh, no, no, no. Okay, okay, everything's okay. Okay, let's maybe space this out a little bit more. And of course, later we can just have them compact. Yeah, here we'll see how that works, because we have to knot it. Twelve, 36, 13, and that's probably 37. And this is 38, and this is then probably 14. The output goes back on green. Because it outputs input count. I guess we can't do that then. What we can do is just have a diode here for opcode and function. This way The signal doesn't can't loop. So it still have function and opcode, but the D value doesn't loop around. Yeah, and I believe this. There are parallel path, data paths here that are longer anyway, so I think this diode doesn't add any total length, I believe. But we get our D value. I mean, actually, we have to put it onto two red cables anyway. We don't have to put it on green. We either put that on. What actually goes into the address of the memory, which is weird. Oh no, no, actually it's not weird. So it either is W on control or it might go into write data. So why don't we just do that? Actually always goes into the address of the memory. So maybe let's do that first, right? So it's either read or write actually in the memory, so it can be W. Actually, let's take a if then. Oh no, need to rename it though. So D times my writing flag, which I will just add the push button in a second, will be W. So the write address. And otherwise we read, I guess I'll just do really D here. So we'll get that on D back on our, from the memory. For data maybe. Yeah. And then we also wait, that's it, right? Oh, give me a second, maybe that's not it yet. So this will be, oh, this should be a push button really. So this will pulse this one. Now where does it go as well? It also goes into write data into the register. But that's muxed as well. And we maybe move this over here. Because, so if we have mem to rec set, D times, let's call this, I believe I used one in here already, and this is only temporary, so let's call it two for now, will be the actually written data, so I, which goes to the registers. This already goes to registers. Oh, this is the right address. And this is the input data. So the right data. And this is on if memtrack is 0. So 2 is memtrack for now. Or not memtrack actually. And otherwise it will take the written the data that we read from memory, which is on D, right? And I call this 3 for now. So we just have 2 or 3. That's the filters here. Put that on I. And this goes into the write data of I believe this one. Take as input the D value, right? But yeah, unfortunately, over time, we basically built some parts of this decoding here. We already built this mux. Now we skipped the sign extension, but we built this mux. Basically, that's above our ALU, which is this row of add, subtraction, and the also the part of the ALU is where we select which output is the correct one. For that we are not using the ALU control, but we directly use the opcode and function. The function is this part here, and the opcode would be derived from the ALU op here. So we do that. The result now, we already put it to this address here, I believe. And we are just building this mux, I believe, which goes into the write data of the registers from either the read data or the ALU result. So I believe we have this part, actually all this part, almost finished. Well, at least parts of it. We don't have all the ALU operations. Yeah, so I hope you enjoyed watching, and we will continue next time.